Good afternoon.
In February, we maintained what many considered a bold decision to raise rates to 0.75%. Despite further falls in inflation, we've decided to once again stick with this rise. Our remit is to bring inflation to a 2% target, whilst recognising the broader government aims of growth and stability. To do so, we must consider the aspects of the economy that could be affecting the UK inflation rate. Alex will start by discussing domestic demand and financial markets, Kieran UK fiscal spending and the international outlook, and finally, Hannah will cover costs and prices. I will conclude by assessing appropriate monetary policy responses. I will now pass on to Alex.
Since our February presentation, the outlook for consumption and investment has remained strong, with the consumer recovery currently fueled by a substantial fall in market interest rates, along with confirmed real wage growth. Real household disposable income has finally begun to rise, with nominal wages growing 1.8% in the 3 months to January, outstripping CPI, which fell to 0.3% over the same period. This upward trend appears likely to continue, with independent forecasts indicating a 3.5% rise in 2015. The savings ratio has generally fallen since 2010, and robust GDP growth, along with rising asset prices, should boost consumer confidence, encouraging further falls in the near term. GfK consumer confidence is 8 index points higher than a year ago, despite suffering a short-term dip in the fourth quarter of 2014. According to the latest quarterly Deloitte consumer tracker, UK consumer confidence regarding disposable income has risen to a 3-year high, even without substantial increases in wages. Recent data released by the Society of Motor Manufacturers showed 9.3% growth in the new car market in 2014, suggesting households are beginning to re-enter the luxury goods market and release pent-up demand for big-ticket items. Falling unemployment should also encourage consumption by boosting confidence. Consumer credit conditions improved markedly over the past year, with bank figures indicating that unsecured lending was 40% higher than in 2013. In addition, recent falls in fixed-term mortgage rates and stamp duty reforms look set to boost the housing market, so raising the base rate now should help to prevent overheating. Retail sales volumes rose by an unexpected 2.3% in the fourth quarter of last year, the strongest quarterly growth rate since 2002. While I think it is unlikely that sales figures will remain quite this strong, the prospects for the consumer recovery in 2015-16 appear promising. The outlook for UK investment has generally remained positive since November, with ONS data indicating it is 7% above its pre-crisis peak. Although business investment fell by 1.4% in the fourth quarter of 2014, my view is that this reflects a sharp cancellation of investment plans in North Sea oil, something which Wednesday's budget measures may relieve. Lower oil prices may in fact boost non-oil investment over the medium term, which continues to be supported by expanding domestic demand and substantial accumulated profits. Indeed, business investment rose by 6.8% over 2014 as a whole, its fastest annual growth rate in 7 years. Furthermore, many larger firms are benefiting from cheaper credit, and with rising business optimism, we expect a significant increase in corporate investment. Turning to SME investment intentions, a recent ICAEW survey of 500 SMEs found that 78% would not be adversely affected by a rate rise, while 75% held cash reserves and were not currently borrowing. Concerns about the viability of SMEs if rates were to rise therefore seem overblown. In summary, high disposable income and confidence should help to boost consumption, leading to demand pull inflationary pressure in the medium term. Raising the base rate to counteract this should have a limited effect on investment, since rising revenues and high margins are likely to offset the increased interest rate costs for companies. We believe that raising rates would thus improve the allocation of capital without hindering investment, promoting both economic growth and price stability. Bank health has improved considerably since the crisis, with leverage ratios at 5.8% last year, more than double their 2008 level. In addition, rising core Tier 1 capital ratios indicate that banks have largely repaired their balance sheets and are now better placed to lend. The annual growth rate of broad money picked up from an average of 3.7% in 2014 to 4.2% in January, while bank lending rose to a 5-month high. These figures signify that constraints on the recovery from the financial sector are gradually easing. High equity prices could also create upside inflationary risk, with the FTSE 100 surpassing its 1999 peak last month. although this might only reflect volatility, we believe that low cyclically adjusted price-to-earnings ratios suggest there is still reasonable scope for stock market growth over the next few years. Overall, stronger financial markets look set to support the recovery in domestic demand. Increasing bank resilience should help to inspire confidence in the financial sector, while equity markets have the potential to grow sustainably without causing a bubble. We therefore believe that financial markets are likely to provide significant upward inflationary pressure in the medium term. I'll now hand over to Kieran.
I will be discussing the fiscal and international outlook, which arguably present the most significant challenge to our team's decision, and have led me to disagree with such tightening of monetary policy. However, since February, the risks are perhaps less significant. Borrowing is on course to be substantially greater over this Parliament than the 2010 OBR forecasts, with Wednesday's budget suggesting borrowing that borrowing will be at $75.3 billion in 2015-16. Existing fiscal plans suggest austerity will continue over the forecast period, with the budget deficit forecast to fall over the next Parliament, reaching a surplus by 2018-19. The outcome of the election is anybody's guess, but we suspect that the current fiscal constraints mean the future government will have little scope for policy changes. International factors affect aggregate demand through three transmission mechanisms: trade, investment, and confidence. While the UK is now growing above trend, there have been some concerns about the outlook of our trading partners. With Eurozone output weakening, recent deflation, and a Greek exit or default still a significant risk, the EU looks likely to struggle. However, on the upside, Eurozone core inflation was most recently measured at 0.6%, and the ECB has recently revised up the forecast for this year's growth. Recently initiated 1.1 trillion euros of QE by the ECB are likely to have a positive effect on market confidence, as shown by the boost in the European bond market. There is also the potential to boost government spending as a result of much lower lending costs. As Governor Carney has said, France hasn't borrowed this cheaply since the 1750s. This could stimulate European growth as a whole. The balance of payments deficit in recent years has been as a result of a negative net investment income and a strong sterling. Despite December's worrying data, trade data for January is very positive, with the trade deficit down to 0.6 billion, although we are aware that this is only 1 month's data. The OBR have forecast the current account to improve in the medium term, but I personally have my doubts. In order to get an idea of how demand for our exports is likely to change in the medium term, we have created a weighted average for growth of the UK's export destinations. This shows potential for positive growth in our export sector. As we have discussed over past rounds, we hope that the US would help to take up some of the slack of a weaker Europe. Recent figures suggest this, with US Q3 growth at 5% and Q4 growth at 2.6%. Market sentiment indicates that the Fed is likely to raise rates in late Q2, and with strong new labour data since our February presentation, this seems even more likely. The resulting depreciation of the pound on the dollar could be good for UK trade. The strengthening of the dollar is likely to increase levels of imported inflation into the UK, and this could also help to reduce the exchange rate impact of our proposed interest rate rise. Sterling is currently falling against the dollar, but has reached record highs against the euro, resulting in a 5% rise in sterling ERI in the last 2 months. However, the export risk of this may in part be offset by the fact that many UK exporters are responding by lowering their sterling prices in order to remain competitive. To conclude, both the fiscal outlook and international considerations continue to present a mixed picture. Several sizable downside risks loom, and for me, an immediate rate rise remains premature. For this reason, I continue to disagree with my more hawkish colleagues.
Since February, trends in factor prices presented a confusing picture, with prices of services rising 2.4% and goods falling by 1.5%. Rising wage growth and falling oil are driving these two divergent trends. Unemployment continues to fall, dropping to 5.7% this month, a seven-year low, and a further fall from February. In fact, labour markets have reached all-time highs in employment. The OBR estimated that unemployment is set to reach the Nauru threshold. This is consistent with a rapid absorption of slack. Full-time employment has started to recover. This, combined with less underemployment, signals wage rises are imminent. Wage growth has been surprisingly subdued, but this is mainly due to temporary compositional changes. Recent wage data has been more optimistic, The recovery in the job market is at last starting to filter through, with wages growing at their fastest rate in 2 years. I was interested to read in the FT, wage growth in the construction industry has been driven to double figures. While this is an anecdotal example, such instances of supply bottlenecks may trigger more generalised upwards wage pressure. Other measures, such as the REC index of starting salaries, corroborate this, illustrating diminishing slack. As workers gain more confidence and labour turnover rises, we should see higher wage growth feeding through to higher unit labour costs, especially given very low productivity gains. The CBI reported that over the next year, firms expect their wage cost per person to increase by 1.5%. We have conducted a quarterly survey of over 400 school parents, including householders and business owners. In February, 53% of business owners were looking to recruit in the next year, and nationally, firms' recruitment difficulties have returned to pre-crisis peaks. The productivity puzzle leads to uncertainties about how fast the UK could grow without generating inflationary pressure. Productivity has been stagnant for the past 7 years, and we forecast very little of this lost productivity will be regained. So, the economy may have less potential to grow without generating upside inflationary risk. With unemployment falling and real salaries rising, we think the labour market should be sufficiently robust for a modest normalisation in rates. After falling by over 60% in the past 6 months, oil prices have settled at $54 a barrel this morning, a slight fall since February. It remains to be seen whether this recent reversal proves to just be a dead cat bounce or the start of a sustained recovery. Prices are set to rise in the medium term, with increasing Middle East tension and reduced oil rig counts in the US. By the end of 2016, we forecast oil to settle at $65 a barrel. Our view is supported by the market sentiment. The oil's futures curve remains in contango, as it was in November and in February. In fact, the future price implied this month is higher than implied last month. But even if prices don't rise, just merely stagnate, the recent price fall will be a one-off shock, which will drop out of the CPI index within a year. This base effect will produce a sharp snapback of inflation of around 0.6%. Commodity prices have begun to fall more broadly, with specifically large falls in copper and coffee. Wholesale energy costs have also fallen, and this has started to be passed through. This could contribute to some lowflation, and maybe even some deflation. However, it is good news in some ways, providing a welcome boost to consumption. We will be observing whether these lower prices pass through into non-fuel items. A recent Deloitte survey showed firms' inflation expectations are just below the 2% target. However, household expectations are at 2.5% on a one-year horizon and 3% at a 5 to 10 year horizon. This is supported by the implied future inflation given by the gilt yield curve. Clearly, the MPC's fears over contagious deflation are not shared by the country at large. To summarise, it appears domestic inflation is being stoked, in a dichotomy with subdued inflation from exogenous sources. As members of the MPC, we cannot wait for all our indicators to be in line. The labour market has been reacting slowly, but inflationary pressure is building in the pipeline, pressure that will be harder to curtail if we do not act now. My analysis suggests that responding to CPI perhaps won't lead to optimal policy decisions. We have to accept that some costs lie beyond our influence. While these do need to be monitored, in my opinion, our primary focus should be on core inflation, which, as you can see from the chart, has been rising for the past 3 months. I'd like to explain a statistical project we've been working on. Like the bank, we see great merit in not just forecasting, but adding a confidence interval around that forecast. Some economists have criticised the bank for repeatedly underestimating inflation. This prompted us to make our own empirical fan chart based on historical Bank of England forecasting. We first compared the market forecast to the bank forecast. On average, the bank forecasts were 12 basis points lower than the market forecasts. Secondly, we compared the bank forecast to the actual inflation 8 quarters ahead. There was a significant discrepancy. On average, the bank underpredicted inflation by 93 basis points. Clearly, inflation is difficult to forecast. Using this empirical data, we can simulate the probable outcomes of inflation on a 2-year horizon. We have assumed that the Bank of England's bias to underpredict inflation continues and that errors remain at historical levels. We used a Monte Carlo simulation of over 10,000 inflation future outcomes, which gives a striking graphical representation of the upside risk to inflation on a two-year horizon. As the cumulative distribution shows, this empirical model predicts there is an 85% chance that inflation will be above the 2% target in quarter one, 2017, and the most probable outcome of inflation is around 3%, suggesting inflationary risk over the forecast period is strongly biased to the upside. To create our own empirical fan chart, we took the Bank of England central forecast for each quarter forward and added the mean forecast error corresponding to that quarter, with a variety of standard deviations as shown. This statistical investigation has helped us to form a strong and empirically grounded argument. Jack will now explain our policy conclusion.
Inflation is currently below target, but in our view, we need to look through inflation's temporary movements. This is no new idea. The Bank of England has previously looked through its main objective, most recently in 2008, where inflation was well above target and rising, but monetary policy was loosened and kept loose despite high inflation over 2011. In fact, the bank has raised rates in below target conditions almost as many times as it has when inflation was above target. We have seen that waiting too long can cause further problems. We saw the consequences of this in the US in the mid-2000s, when the Fed held the target rate at 1% for too long and then pushed it up quickly to over 5% between late 2004 and early 2006. We should look past the current inflation to the underlying factors. Our prediction is that by the end of the forecast period, CPI will be close to target with substantial upside risks, so we need to act now to prevent potential overshooting. As the labour market tightens, inflation will start to pick up very quickly, and interest rates need to rise to a more normal level before this occurs. We should not look at an interest rate rise as such, but as a return to an appropriate level. Current rates were set in the midst of an economic crisis where every possible boost to the economy was needed. With a discretionary base rate, it is key to keep note of the natural rate of about 2%. Keeping interest rates below this level risks increased inflation through the cumulative process. While the exact rate is disputed, our research shows most estimates is well above current market interest rates, and this will contribute more and more to inflation as the recovery improves. We must, of course, still consider the negative effects on the rise, on businesses and on households. Our survey data shows that 73% of households would not reduce their spending under an immediate 0.25% rate increase, with just 2% suggesting any kind of large reduction. 34% of businesses suggested some impact on their investment decisions, but just 2% said there'd be a large impact, perhaps because a rise is increasingly factored into their planning. In our latest survey, we asked respondents to comment on their spending and investment decisions in the coming year. Similar to the bank's network of regional advisors talking to people around the country, we saw the need for personal responses. Here is a selection of comments sent to us. This data is promising, but there are further potential problems. It is certain that some borrowers will be affected, and this could have some element of dampening on the economy. We believe that this would be absorbed by the current general recovery, and furthermore, market rates have been falling since 2008. We do, however, need to address the elephant in the room that is deflation. Current inflation is very low, and while we feel that this is a superficial result of oil price falls, numerical deflation is possible. But we believe that this is not a serious problem for our conclusion. Firstly, because the full effect of our rate rise would come into effect more than a year after this potential deflation is predicted to be fully gone. And secondly, because this deflation is extremely unlikely to become a spiral in the whole economy. Spending deferral does not apply to fuel and energy markets. And furthermore, fuel cost falls are unlikely to be passed on by suppliers who expect costs to rise again within 18 months. With these factors considered, we feel that the actual negative impact of a rise in interest rates is overshadowed by the importance of normalization. Therefore, we believe a tightening of monetary policy now is necessary. Developments since our November and February presentations have caused some debate, and indeed, this is still not a unanimous decision. Kieran has concerns with our conclusion. There are several possible monetary policies. Firstly, we are unenthusiastic about forward guidance. Next, there is QE to consider. Like the MPC, we believe that reversing QE should only follow a rate normalisation. Given this, we are keeping asset holdings at £375 billion. We conclude that the rate should rise by 25 basis points. This will begin our journey on a path back towards a normal monetary stance with only a low risk of derailing the recovery. Today's MPC faces the unique challenge of moving towards normalised policy, which we believe our final recommendation accomplishes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Great. I applaud your honesty for admitting to differences of opinion. With a journalist in the room, of course, there'll be a story tomorrow about divisions at the Perse School. I presume Phil will also be describing this morning's competitors of having groupthink, because they did not confess to any divisions, and I applaud that. And also your Monte Carlo experiment. I would ask you to go and weigh and see what happens if you run the same thing using the inflation forecast right back to the beginning of inflation talking in 92, but before we had the current jump, because I suspect that a lot of your predictions rest on the fact that the MPC underpredicted inflation between 2010 and 2013. But I was going to ask a question about, and I will warn you right at the beginning, this question has no definitive answer, so don't try and come for one, but about, quotes, the neutral interest rate. You said you thought it was 2% in real terms, or that estimates were around that level. Why in that case, with real interest rates having been below that, at least real short-term risk-free interest rates in this country having been below that, I would suggest probably for about the last 10 years, have we not had rip-roaring inflation over that period?
I'm sorry, can you just clarify, what period are you talking about?
Well, I think if I look, say, at the front end of the index gilt curve, it's been below 2%, I would suggest, for most of the last 10 years, if not all of it. So, I mean, as I say, I'm not looking for any definitive answer, but let me ask it in slightly vaguer terms. Do you think that neutral interest rate can change over time?
We definitely feel that the neutral interest rate can change over a period. I would liken it to the long-run rate of productivity, which is definitely able to change with structural changes. The most significant thing going on at the moment to the natural rate of interest is secular stagnation. I think we have various factors that would explain that. Firstly, an aging population and a decreased appetite for risk.
Real interest rate, it would be affected by factors other than purely interest rates. So as we've seen recently, falls in oil prices have led to decreasing CPI, even though perhaps the natural rate, as Jack suggested, is actually significantly higher. And this is partly why we think we should raise rates now, because it's not really relevant exactly where the neutral rate is, because it's all forecasts really suggest that it's significantly higher than where it currently is, and we believe the economy is currently able to withstand a gentle normalization.
Just to extend your time period slightly, I mean, I can definitely say that there has been a decrease in the natural rate since, for example, the 60s, where it's estimated to be more around 4%. Now, like I said, it's 2%, as estimated by several sources that we looked at. I think it's general changes in the UK and the global economy. Development is a big part of it. Like I said, secular stagnation.
Very much. David.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I particularly like your Monte Carlo simulations, based on the cruel but entirely accurate observation that the MPC has, on the whole, in recent years, underestimated inflation, although actually over the last year we've overestimated inflation. But I wanted to ask you a question about your decision that you're going to raise bank rate. And the market is not really expecting that to happen for quite a while, probably for another year or so. So it would be a bit of a surprise. And I wondered whether you had thought about the potential impact on the exchange rate, which has gone up a bit over the last few months. And relative to where we were a couple of years ago, sterling is up maybe 15% or so. How concerned are you that an unexpected increase in interest rates, even though it's quite a small one, an unexpected increase in interest rates actually might increase the value of sterling by, who knows, 5, 6, 7, even 10%? And what would be the impacts of that on inflation.
So, as the dissenter, one of my key arguments against the interest rate rise was the potential impact on sterling. So, sterling futures curves currently suggest that the markets expect an interest rate rise in around a year's time. So, the potential shock to this could mean a significant rapid strengthening of the sterling. This could cause significant damage to the economy and specifically our trade at a time where the euro is being depreciated. And the euro being our main trading partner, that could have significant implications for our competitiveness on the continent.
To provide the opposite side of the argument to Kieran, I was really interested in a recent Kristen Forbes speech where she was talking about the pass-through of the impacts of a sterling might be much more rapid than originally anticipated, which would have a minimal impact on GDP, and it would have a deflationary impact on inflation in the short term, but it would produce a sharp snapback of inflation once those pass-through effects have gone through. Also, another point is that bank staff estimated that the falls in oil prices have contributed 1% to UK-weighted global GDP, which has boosted UK exporters by 2.5%. And although this may not entirely offset the maybe increases in sterling, it will definitely dampen the effect. One final thing, the reason why we have decided to initiate a small interest rate rise before doing anything with asset purchasing is to minimise the shocks to the market. Markets are very used to interest rate rises, and this is a small increment. We felt that if we had sequenced QE first, then followed by interest rates, it could have led to a lot of volatility in the gilt markets. I think Carney said that considerations on QE would only be sensible once we had seen a couple of rate rises, and we mirror that view.
I mean, coming back to the impediments on sterling, there are potentially, at least in the near term, we could see the general election with the sort of possibilities of an EU referendum or higher taxation. Those could potentially lead to uncertainty, so we could see wealth flowing out of the UK. So there are a number of short-term impacts, at least, where we would be uncertain on what would happen to sterling, on sterling. Of course, also the I think yesterday or 2 days ago, the Fed is no longer patient about raising rates. So the US is also thinking about raising rates. So we're not completely out on a limb here. And of course, the dollar is appreciating faster than the pound.
Thank you. I just wanted a great set of charts in the modelling, and I thoroughly enjoyed your Monte Carlo distribution, which I should nab for the Times. I just want to ask you about wages, because wages are still relatively, the most recent wages was 1.8% growth, which is significantly below, what you would describe as normal wage growth. You say it's passing through because productivity is going to stay low, so unit labour costs go up. But actually, at the moment, we've seen a plateauing in the last month's data. I mean, this is where the inflationary pressures seem to be coming from, because you're looking domestically, really. Do you not think that possibly you need to see a bit more of this data on wages before launching the rate rise? And why haven't you waited?
So addressing the point that we perhaps would want to see further wage rises, we should bear in mind, of course, that any changes in monetary policy, in particular with interest rates, will take about, usually it's predicted to have about, take a year time lag to have any impact on output, another 2 years on inflation. So potentially by the time we start to see significant wage growth, we might have to raise rates very quickly to combat that. And sort of starting normalization now, as Jack, I think, mentioned, it will have it'll take a while to feed through, and we're sort of anticipating that. And we can also, sort of through our gradualist policies, we can see what impact raising the interest rate will have after such a prolonged sort of 6 year period of low interest rates, see where the markets are now more sensitive to base rate changes, And if they are, of course, we can set monetary policy accordingly.
We have, of course, spent a lot of time thinking about whether we could be starting too early and whether that could be a problem for the UK's recovery. We're trying to avoid mistakes similar to the one made by the Swedish Riksbank in 2010. I think our circumstances are different. And as Alex has just said, and as I mentioned in my conclusion, waiting too long can have just as much of an issue for our economy. So it's about finding the right balance, and we believe that's right now.
Okay, thank you. Like Ben, I'd like to commend you on admitting to having differences of opinion amongst your committee, particularly as I myself have been in a minority fairly recently. I'd also like to congratulate you on your new term, which I think I'm going to use in the MPC in future, which is lowflation, which is a good alternative to deflation. It's not what I've come across, at least. My question is really, given that you have differences of opinion, I'd just like to ask each of you in turn, what would be the one element in the outlook that would have to change relative to the outlook that you have presented to us that would cause you to change your vote in the different directions that you...
I'll start. The thing that I would really put a lot of weight on, especially regarding, like you said, lowflation, deflation, is inflationary expectations. And there are a number of ways we can observe this. We can look at the gilt yield curve, the differences. We can look at firms' inflation expectations. We can look at household inflation expectations. The thing that would be really worrying if a deflationary mindset were to set in, and as a team, we don't think this is particularly likely. There hasn't been any evidence of a willingness to delay spending, perhaps because of such things such as prospect theory. People discount the future, they're more likely to spend now. Retail sales volumes have been particularly strong, so there's no empirical evidence of delayed spending. And household expectations are very well anchored, so that would be if household expectations started to rapidly decrease, becoming unanchored to our inflation target, that would be the most worrying indicator for me.
So personally for me, my main concerns lie within Europe, as that's kind of the area that I've done most of my research in. So Greece specifically, I believe, still presents a significant threat, as while they are proposing austerity and they do seem to be softening their stance a small amount, 100 million euros of QE just isn't enough when your debt ratio is roughly 180% of your GDP. So I personally feel that the Greek situation is unsustainable, and that's why I remain against a rate rise. However, what would basically convince me that this is appropriate is were the... were there to be greater certainty over Greece. So if Greece were to succeed in arranging an appropriate bailout plan with the ECB, that would create greater confidence within Europe and possibly limit the impact that parties such as Podemos in Spain and Alternative for Deutschland in Germany are having on confidence in the Eurozone and the risk of the potential Eurozone breakup, which I believe a Greek exit could cause.
I mean, in the areas where I've done most research, so domestically, I found really very little evidence that could potentially be concerning. I suppose the main areas, if we see sort of lower oil investment dragging down other forms of investment more generally, that would be a concern. But I think that's unlikely, and I think generally, actually, for me, it's almost on the other side, because if we see, for instance, with the housing market, so in with lower mortgage rates, we stamp duty reforms from the autumn statement, and Wednesday's sort of pension reforms, with potentially up to 50,000 pensioners being able to buy second homes because they can take out, rather than buying annuities, they can take out from their pension pots. If we see things like this push up the housing market, I think actually I'd almost bounce the other side, and I would be more concerned about the need to raise rates.
For me, as Hannah mentioned, we've been looking into core inflation. As I mentioned in my conclusion, I personally don't believe that a spiral of deflation to the whole economy is likely. I'm not even sure I think any numerical deflation is likely either. However, were that to occur, and were specifically core inflation to start to lower, as we would see a general good price decrease and service price increase, that would definitely get me to change my decision, because that could be very long lasting. I mean, I've watched intently what's happened in Japan, and I don't want the same thing to happen to the UK. So that would certainly change my decision.
Well done, Neil. Thank you very much.